Good morning, good morning, good morning. Today's video is going to be about how super intelligence is going to change the world. Enjoy. It's probably going to be like 20 minutes.
Do you know how AI will affect your life in the future?
So this is my niece. Her name is Yali. Her mum is a doctor and her dad is a lawyer. By the time Yali goes to college, the jobs her parents do are going to look dramatically different. In 2013, researchers at Oxford University did a study on the future of work. They concluded that almost one in every two jobs have a high risk of being automated by machines. Now, machine learning is the technology that's responsible for most of this disruption. It's the most powerful branch of artificial intelligence. It allows machines to learn from data and mimic some of the things that humans can do.
I'm going to talk a little bit about where technology is going. Often technology comes to us, we're surprised by what it brings, but there's actually a large aspect of technology that's much more predictable. And that's because technological systems of all sorts have leanings, they have urgencies, they have tendencies. So in a large sense, I would say that telephones were inevitable, but the iPhone was not. The internet was inevitable, but Twitter was not. And so we have many ongoing tendencies right now, and I think one of the chief among them is this tendency to make things smarter and smarter. I call it cognification, also known as artificial intelligence, or AI.
I'm Jeff Dean. I'm a Google Senior Fellow at Google. It means that I get to spend my time working on problems that I think are the most important for the company. I'm working on artificial intelligence. I lead the Google Brain Team, our artificial intelligence research team based in Mountain View, California. Our team does long-term research on how to make machines intelligent. Rather than trying to embody machines with everything they need to know up front, rather, we want to enable them to learn, to learn how to learn. We're going to expose a system to examples of the behavior we want it to have. And those examples are going to teach it. It's going to learn from those examples how to do something. The field of deep learning is a particular kind of machine learning that I'll be talking about. And it's been shown in the last 4 or 5 years to be remarkably effective for a wide variety of problems. So in this very simple diagram, and we're going to have examples where we know the right answer. So we have some that we say, that's a cat, that's a dog, that's a dog, that's a cat. We're going to make little adjustments to how we believe about what we believe about the world and what we believe about this example to make it more likely that the next time we see that example or one like it, we'll get the right answer. Deep learning in particular has a particular way of doing this that is really important. So it builds these layers of abstraction automatically as part of the learning process, which is really critical aspect of deep learning. We don't have to tell it how to tell a cat from a dog. It just learns that there's these things called whiskers, and they seem to appear in lots of photos, and they seem to appear more often in ones about cats. Neural nets can learn much more than just how do you tell a cat from a dog. They can learn to distinguish thousands of different categories of objects, you know, tens of thousands. They can learn from an audio stream to give you a transcript of the words that were said in that audio stream. They can take in an English sentence, hello, how are you, and spit out the corresponding French sentence, bonjour, comment allez-vous. They can take in the pixels of an image and give you more than just a category about it. They can actually write a sentence, a caption, if you will. That shows a pretty high level of understanding of what's going on in that scene. One of the great things about deep learning is that all of those things that I showed you can be expressed using a relatively simple set of algorithms. So we can build a software framework that enables us to express all these different learning problems and then use it over and over for our research and for our products. And so the system we built is called TensorFlow. And we use it internally for everything that we do. And last year, we decided we would open source it because we wanted people to have the ability to take this software, download it for free, and use it for their learning problems. Neural nets are not new. They've actually been around since the 1980s and 1990s, and they showed really promising results on kind of small toy problems. We just lacked enough computational power. The process of making these adjustments to the model on every example and processing every example many times in order to build this model of the world is very computationally intensive. Fortunately, we have faster computers now. Computers have been dramatically improving in performance every year for the last 30 to 40 years, and we've reached this point where neural nets are actually practical on real problems. So the computer you have in your phone is now 100 to 1,000 times as powerful as the computers you had on your desktop 20 or 30 years ago. So essentially, there's a video camera for each robot that's gonna take the pixel inputs from the camera, and they're essentially just gonna, through trial and error, practice picking things up. And they're pretty good at it. We bought a bunch of variety packs of toys and tools on Amazon. Another area where I think machine learning has incredible opportunities is in the area of healthcare. So diabetic retinopathy is the fastest growing cause of blindness in the world. There's 400 million people at risk who should really get screened basically every year, but often people don't get the screening they should. So we got a large collection of these eye images and we had human ophthalmologists label them. Two human ophthalmologists score these. They agree with their rating 60% of the time. Slightly more worrisome though is if you ask the same ophthalmologist to grade the same image a few hours later, they only agree with themselves 65% of the time. And it's really just a hard problem, right? It's sort of an interpretation of like, how dark are those spots? Should that be a 2 or a 3 in this rating scale? So in work published earlier this week by our group in the Journal of the American Medical Association, we now have a machine learning model that performs on par, perhaps even slightly better than ophthalmologists at this task. And this is really important because it can make ophthalmologists much more efficient. They can actually dedicate their time to the people who deserve the attention and not spend as much time on screening most of the people, most of whom don't have any signs of this. By having tools that understand the art we're trying to create, we'll also be more creative. Leon Gaddis and his colleagues from the University of Tübingen published this amazing paper where they have an algorithm that can take an image and a painting. And what the algorithm does is it renders that photograph in the style of that painter. So here you see that same picture rendered in 3 different styles automatically by those 3 different artists. And I think there's going to be a real opportunity to create tools for human artists that allow them to really get the ideas in their head out into really new and creative kinds of art. We want more computational power so that we can train larger models so we can learn more.
Any further changes that could significantly change the substrate of thinking could have potentially enormous consequences. Some of my colleagues think we are on the verge of something that could cause a profound change in that substrate, and that is machine superintelligence. Artificial intelligence used to be about putting commands in a box. You would have human programmers that would painstakingly handcraft knowledge items. You build up these expert systems, and they were kind of useful for some purposes, but they were very brittle. You couldn't scale them. Basically, you got out only what you put in. And since then, a paradigm shift has taken place in the field of artificial intelligence. Today, the action is really around machine learning. So rather than handcrafting features, we create algorithms that learn, often from raw perceptual data. Basically, the same thing that the human infant does. The result is AI that is not limited to one domain. The same system can learn to translate between any pairs of languages, or learn to play any computer game at the Atari console. Now, of course, AI is still nowhere near having the same powerful cross-domain ability to learn and plan as a human being has. The cortex still has some algorithmic tricks that we don't yet know how to match in machines. But so the question is, how far are we from being able to match those tricks? A couple of years ago, we did a survey of some of the world's leading AI experts to see what they think. And one of the questions we asked was, by which year do you think there is a 50% probability that we will have achieved human-level machine intelligence? And the median answer was 2040 or 2050, depending on precisely which group of experts we asked. Now, it could happen much, much later or sooner. Like, truth is, nobody really knows. What we do know is that the ultimate limits to information processing in machine substrate lie far outside the limits in biological tissue. This comes down to physics. A biological neuron fires maybe at 200 hertz, 200 times a second. But even a present-day transistor operates at 1 gigahertz. Neurons propagate slowly in axons, 100 meters per second tops. But in computers, signals can travel at the speed of light. There are also size limitations, like a human brain has to fit inside a cranium, but a computer can be the size of a warehouse or larger. So the potential for superintelligence kind of lies dormant in matter, much like the power of the atom lied dormant throughout human history until 1945. In this century, scientists may learn to awaken the power of artificial intelligence. And I think we might then see an intelligence explosion. Now, most people, when they think about what is smart and what is dumb, I think have in mind a picture roughly like this. So at one end, we have sort of the village idiot. And then far over at the other side, we have Ed Witten or Albert Einstein, or whoever your favorite sort of guru is. I think that from the point of view of artificial intelligence, the true picture is actually probably more like this. AI starts out at this point here, at zero intelligence. And then after many, many years of really hard work, maybe eventually we get to mouse level artificial intelligence, something that can navigate cluttered and requirements as well as a mouse can. And then after many, many more years of really hard work, lots of investment, maybe eventually we get to chimpanzee level artificial intelligence. And then after even more years of really, really hard work, we get to village idiot artificial intelligence. And a few moments later, we are beyond Ed Witten. The train doesn't stop at Humanville station. It's likely rather to swoosh right by. Now this has profound implications, particularly when it comes to questions of power. For example, chimpanzees are strong. Like pound for pound, a chimpanzee is about twice as strong as a fit human male. And yet, the fate of Tanzi and his pals now depends a lot more on what we humans do than on what the chimpanzees do themselves. Once there is superintelligence, the fate of humanity may depend on what the superintelligence does. Think about it. Machine intelligence is the last invention that humanity will ever need to make. The machines will then be better at inventing than we are, and they'll be doing so on digital timescales. What this means is basically a telescoping of the future. So think of all the crazy technologies that we could have imagined maybe humans could have developed in the fullness of time. So cures for aging, space colonization, self-replicating nanobots, or uploading of minds into computers, all kinds of science fiction stuff that's nevertheless consistent with the laws of physics. All of this, a superintelligence could develop, and possibly quite rapidly. Now, a superintelligence with such technological maturity would be extremely powerful, and at least in some scenarios, it would be able to get what it wants. We would then have a future that would be shaped by the preferences of this AI. Now, a good question is, what are those preferences? Here it gets trickier. To make any headway with this, we must first of all avoid anthropomorphizing. And this is ironic because every newspaper article about the future of AI has a picture of this. So I think what we need to do is to conceive of the issue more abstractly, not in terms of vivid Hollywood scenarios. We need to think of intelligence as an optimization process, a process that steers the future into a particular set of configurations. A superintelligence is a really strong optimization process. It's extremely good at using available means to achieve a state in which its goal is realized. This means that there is no necessary connection between being highly intelligent in this sense and having an objective that we humans would find worthwhile or meaningful. Suppose we give an AI the goal to make humans smile. When the AI is weak, it performs useful or amusing actions that cause its user to smile. When the AI becomes super intelligent, it realizes that there is a more effective way to achieve this goal. Take control of the world and like stick electrodes into the facial muscles of humans to cause constant beaming grins. Take another example. Suppose we give AI the goal to solve a difficult mathematical problem. When the AI becomes super intelligent, it realizes that the most effective way to get the solution to this problem is by transforming the planet into a giant computer so as to increase its thinking capacity. And notice that this gives the AI an instrumental reason to do things to us that we might not approve of. Human beings in this model are threats. We could prevent the mathematical problem from being solved. Now, of course, presumably things won't go wrong in these particular ways, right? These are cartoon examples. But the general point here is important. If you create a really powerful optimization process to maximize for objective X, you better make sure that your definition of X incorporates everything you care about. This is a lesson that's also taught in many a myth. King Midas wishes that everything it touches be turned into gold. It touches his daughter, she turns into gold. It touches his food, it turns into gold. This could become practically relevant, not just as a metaphor for greed, but as an illustration of what happens if you create a powerful optimization process and give it a misconceived or poorly specified goal. Now you might say, well, if a computer starts sticking electrodes into people's faces, like, we just shut it off. A, this is not necessarily so easy to do if we've grown dependent on the system. Like, where is the off switch to the internet? B, why haven't the chimpanzees flicked the off switch to humanity? The reason is that we are an intelligent adversary. We can anticipate threats and plan around them, but so could a super intelligent agent, and it would be much better at that than we are. Point is, we should not be confident that we have this under control here, and we could try to make our job a little bit easier by, say, putting the AI in a box, like a secure software environment, a virtual reality simulation from which it cannot escape. But how confident could we be that the AI couldn't find a bug? Like, given that merely human hackers find bugs all the time, I'd say probably not very confident. If you're the AI, you could maybe output the blueprint to a really nifty technology, and when we implement it, it has some surreptitious side effect that the AI had planned. The point here is that we should not be confident in our ability to keep a super intelligent genie locked up in its bottle forever. Sooner or later, it will out. I believe that the answer here is to figure out how to create superintelligent AI such that even if, when it escapes, it is still safe because it is fundamentally on our side, because it shares our values. I see no way around this difficult problem. Now, I'm actually fairly optimistic that this problem can be solved. Like, we wouldn't have to try to write down a long list of everything we care about, or worse yet, spell it out in some computer language like C++ or Python. Like, that would be a task beyond hopeless. Instead, we would create an AI that uses this intelligence to learn what we value. And his motivation system is constructed in such a way that it is motivated to pursue our values or to perform actions that it predicts that we would have approved of. We would thus leverage its intelligence as much as possible to solve the problem of value loading. This can happen, and the outcome could be very good for humanity, but it doesn't happen automatically. The initial conditions for the intelligent explosion might need to be set up in just the right way if we are to have a controlled detonation. The values that the AI has needs to match ours, not just in the familiar context, like where we can easily check how the AI behaves, but also in all novel contexts that the AI might encounter in the indefinite future. And there are also some other esoteric issues that would need to be solved, the exact details of its decision theory, how to deal with logical uncertainty, and so forth. So the technical problems that need to be solved to make this work look quite difficult. Not as difficult as making a superintelligent AI, but fairly difficult. Here's the worry. Making superintelligent AI is a really hard challenge. Making superintelligent AI that is safe involves some additional challenge on top of that. The risk is that somebody figures out how to crack the first challenge without also having cracked the additional challenge of ensuring perfect safety. So I think that we should work out a solution to the control problem in advance so that we have it available by the time it is needed. Now, it might be that we cannot solve the entire control problem in advance because maybe some elements can only be put in place once we know the details of the architecture where it will be implemented. But the more of the control problem that we solve in advance, the better the odds that the transition to the machine intelligence era will go well. This to me looks like a thing that is well worth doing. And I mean, I could imagine that if things turn out okay, that people a million years from now look back at this century, and it might well be that they say that the one thing we did that really mattered was to get this thing right.
So, the future, where does that take us? I think that 25 years from now, they'll look back right now, and they'll look at our understanding of AI and say, you didn't have AI. In fact, you didn't even have the internet yet, compared to what we're going to have in 25 years from now. And so we are just at the beginning of the beginning. We're in the first hour of all this. We're in the first hour of the internet. We're in the first hour of what's coming. And the most popular AI product in 20 years from now that everybody uses has not been invented yet. Thank you.
That's the video. In my opinion, I think it's really important to keep this in mind, the whole control issue. I like that we have people like Elon Musk who's really trying to do their best to sort of keep humanity's interests at heart while also developing AIs. I think it's a little bit troubling that we have companies like Facebook and Amazon who seems to be rushing it a bit more. They're more interested in being first than getting it 100% safe. I think it's a little bit troubling, but let me know what you guys think in the comments down below. That's really the interesting part for me. I love the conversations we usually have, so feel free to join. You don't have to be an expert on it. And if you have any questions, feel free to come up with them as well. And yeah, if you're new to the channel, then subscribe. I upload videos every single week, and I do my best to make them as interesting as possible. I'll see you guys next week. Take care.